all men seeking the good. And I wondered, why not?
Do you recall saying that?
I was shocked, I tell you, Pierre.
And I don't know, if it's not a good topic for the moment, we can do it another time.
When did he say that?
Would you not agree that that statement refers to things that, and it's most likely understood in this way, external?
Yes, for the most part, that's what they're talking about.
Therefore, it's superficial.
But isn't the argument that, isn't it that even when they seek something that is not good, they think it to be good?
Pardon?
Isn't it that if they seek something, isn't the argument that even if they seek a bad thing, they seek it because they think it is good?
Yeah, that's equally
well,
true.
Well, isn't that though, or they seek it, I'm not sure of the argument at this point, but they seek it for pleasure, and they therefore they think pleasure is good, and it's seeking. I'm wondering whether it's the state of mind they're seeking. So yes, it's an object, but they're seeking to get to be in a certain state of mind. They think they will be benefited. That's the thing. It's not pleasure, but they think they will be benefited.
No, they which
so
is
they're seeking a benefit,
which never follows.
True. But if they seek to be benefited, is that really a thing they're seeking or an effect?
Well, it goes back to the same question, which is, how do we understand the statement, all men seek the good? Do you see them doing something? Are they then engaged in activity?
Yes.
Well, therefore it's fruitless.
Because they're not seeking to know themselves.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not that they seek the, exactly that they seek the bad, it's that they're not seeking the spiritual good.
It's a fiction.
It's a fiction. Well, they seek a fictional good. Is that what you mean?
All goods are fictions to the degree that there are things outside of you that you're going to pursue. It's rhetoric.
That's so interesting.
Including, what about dream work or...
What about...
Dream work or philosophical...
Dream work?
Because that's a doing, that's an action.
Well, like, when you look at, when we were looking at a dream, what's your expectation?
Money. to know myself.
No. It's not, no one is seeking a good independent of some way of understanding themselves. So, what do you guys make of this dialogue? Tell me, while we're letting Jeff have enough time to play, what did you see in it? Were you able to get into it sufficiently?
Sufficiently. Sort of sufficiently.
Okay.
But I read it backwards, so I didn't get to the...
Okay, let me ask you a question. What's so hot about this dialogue? What is it that Socrates is doing? Can you figure it out?
Well, I fell upon an interesting quote in 1988.
He starts out with, hey, what is courage? Right? By the way, do they find out what it is?
I don't think so.
Is it a failure?
Yeah, failure. they say courage is a part of wisdom. So they end up, courage is a part of virtue.
Look here, would you agree, basically the dialogue goes this way. They're trying to present their views, and finally, after they finish talking, Socrates then offers his own position.
Okay.
Agree. And he asks whether or not Nicias can go along with all the things that Socrates says. Right? Essentially what he says is, hey, you know what? Courage is knowing what is dreadful. And what is not, but essentially what is dreadful. And you have to have courage, you see, because it's going to involve you in dangerous situations. They're dangerous because they're dreadful. And that awakens a fear, all right? Whatever you perceive as dreadful, you're going to flee, you're going to escape from it. And the reason you're going to escape is because there's an expectation. The expectation is you're going to experience what is essentially a total failure. You're going to expect doom. Or its opposite, either one. But look here. Then Socrates says, look here, what do you have to do to get this kind of knowledge? He says, now it's a special kind of knowledge. It's a knowledge of the present, past, and future about what's good and what's bad. Okay. Then courage is knowing a certain kind of knowledge. He says, hey, by the way, if you understand this, then you can see it's going to apply to everything in the present, past, and future. So courage is anticipating, right? Is anticipating, and you therefore is likely experience a fear about something that you understand or expect to be dreadful. And the ability then to go through these scenes takes courage. But something wrong here. By the way, are there different kinds of knowledge?
Yeah.
What kind of knowledge will give you knowledge of the present, past, and future, good and bad?
Maybe the knowledge of the stock market?
Yeah, will that give you knowledge of good and bad?
For the economy, it might.
What?
For the economy, it might. Whether the prices are
going to
go up or down?
Yeah, but why would that up and down be good and bad? It just goes up and down all the time.
What about the definition of dream in book 9, is it, in the Republic? The definition of dreams that you can touch truth, and I think you can find out what you do not know about the present, the past, and the future. The good and the bad part, I'm not sure we got there. But dream, right? Mm. If you pursue this practice of dreams in a certain way, then your dreams, in your dreams you will touch truth about the present, the past, and the future.
Okay. Dreams in Book 9 of Plato's Republic say, by the way, you can gain a knowledge, present, past, and future, through visions and dreams, and give you knowledge of the future, good and bad.
Yeah.
No, no. Why didn't he say that?
Why didn't...
Yeah, what is Plato rather foolish? Why did he leave it out?
He wanted to sell more books? No, I don't know. I don't know.
Leave it out here in this dialogue? Is that what you're referring to?
Give you one quote. Tell me what it means. If I give you the quote, you should be able to tell me what it means. Fair enough? Okay. Hmm.
Are you talking about 199D?
Good.
On page 77?
Wow, Jules. Hmm. Very interesting.
Wow.
Could you also say,
Pierre? Yeah, just for a second.
Sure.
Did you read it?
Yeah.
It's a good point for Bear.
I don't know. Check in the morning.
Rather than Bear.
Give the book to you.
Yeah. It's,
Ah. So I have just one quote for you guys. Tell me what it means. I'm on 198B. Okay. What does that mean? Let us pass on. what it is to be dreaded.
Mm. Deinos. It's a word for terrible.
Pardon?
Sorry. It's a word for terrible, that word.
Yeah. Yes, that's true. But go ahead. What does it mean? Daimon, yeah.
Daimon.
Okay. Say, what does that mean?
What does that mean? Oh, he told us to go back? Really?
To do good?
Ooh. Interesting.
To do good?
Pardon me?
To do Sorry. Good?
Do it again?
To do good?
To do good?
Yeah.
See, look here. Would you agree this exploration starts with the recognition of this one idea, dreadful.
Mm-hmm.
Dreadful is talked about, that it's something you can fear. It's something you expect from it that is likely to be a doom. But it presupposes that you know what is dreadful. Would you agree with that? What kinds of things are dreadful? Let us pass on what it is to be dreaded.
Wow. All I could think of is most of the things I dread are in my pathologos. Their beliefs, their fantasies.
A false idea of the self.
A false idea of the self.
A false idea of the self.
Well, see, in terms of the discussion, what does this statement mean in respect to this? Like, let us pass on what it is to be dreaded means he's not going to explain.
What is good?
What is dreaded?
Well, he says let us pass on to what it is to be dreaded.
Well, see,
and that would mean he's going to hit it.
And what is to be dreaded, right?
Right.
But he doesn't tell us that.
Oh, you mean other than the fact that he says the things that cause fear?
No.
Right. Oh, right. He doesn't give a category.
Right. Look here. Does it not raise what fear?
He raises that question, yep.
What kind of doom is he talking about?
What kind of coming evil?
Same thing.
Yep. Expectation.
So what does this do then? Let us pass on to what is dreaded, or as he well puts it, and be dared. They're opposites, and be dared. Does, look here, yes or no, does he explain what kinds of fears?
No.
Does he explain the doom?
No.
Does he even explain what's dreaded?
No.
What's he doing?
Wow. I don't know.
Hey, if you need this kind of knowledge, would you agree? There are all kinds of knowledge. Medicine is a knowledge that allows you to know about things present, past, and future.
Mm-hmm.
And with it, you can decide what's good and bad in respect to that.
Mm-hmm.
Knowledge of seamanship in the same way is a knowledge present, past, and future of what is a fair and what is not a fair journey, and under what conditions you should sail away and what not. Are not all professions possible to be fit here in the knowledge?
Yes.
Well, then, what do you think of this dialogue?
So far, it looks like not worth the paper it's written on, for goodness sakes.
Then, what is it that's going on in this dialogue?
Wow, I don't know.
Fear of your own ignorance.
Okay, let me make it worse. He has an answer to all of these if you look for them in other dialogues.
Hmm.
He's not using what he knows or what he reports in other dialogues.
Right, because one of them is what our friend Eldar just said in the Republic. That's what's to be feared, is to have the false idea of reality. Right?
Look, let's go there, okay? Okay, to have it, to be deceived about it, and to be ignorant about. So look here. In the soul, to have then a false idea of reality. What they call, right, ultimate reality, or ontos,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So however you gained it, to have it here and see through that false image is the source of all kinds of problems. But let me ask you, look here. Is it possible to ask, what would be a true idea of reality? If we know it's the worst thing is to have a false idea, what would be a correct idea to have in your soul?
The first hypothesis.
What you're saying is that this is very interesting, but it's incomplete. And you're now suggesting to find the correct idea, you have to go somewhere else.
Right.
So you're going from the Latches to the Republic, and now you're going from the Republic to the Parmenides. And you have to weave these ideas together, is that right?
Wow.
Is that true? Is that what's going on in Plato?
Is this by design?
Come on, is that what's going on in Plato?
Yeah.
So is it likely that any and all are calls? All the dialogues in themselves are incomplete?
Yeah, from that perspective, yeah.
So what's he doing when he's writing dialogues?
It looks like he's creating mysteries.
Yep, he's creating a mystery.
Puzzles, mysteries.
Right, here's a puzzle, and to get that puzzle, right, you have to go into the time as, or into the theaters, or all the other. Is that right? You have to thread your way. You have to thread your way through these.
Well, maybe it's a matter like he just wanted to write, you know, like the destiny of man versus like the cave of the gods. Like, and he decided like it'd be nice to finish a couple editions to get something down, and then like come back with the big one that brings them all together.
Yeah, well, which dialogue would bring them all together?
Oh, the Parmenides.
Mm.
Yeah.
But would you agree the Parmenides has no examples?
Right.
Bare.
Harsh at that, yeah.
Yeah. So maybe you have to look for examples of it in other dialogues. Oh. Hmm, that's curious. Huh.
Then you'd be looking for like a cemetery.
Pardon?
You'd be looking for a cemetery.
Look. So now you're saying, hey, this is a rather curious author. He raises problems, he leaves you with puzzles. And if you catch the nature of the puzzle in each dialogue, that's going to lead you to others to look for a solution. Hmm.
We return to the beginning.
It's a plot. Either that or it's an invitation. A gift.
Or you have to say he's got a bad memory.
I would be hard pressed to say
like,
Plato had a bad memory.
Like for him to for him to leave it incomplete when we know he has an answer in another dialogue leads us to think the man is either
dementia.
What? These two guys are offering peculiar things that they don't want to hold on to.
Come on.
He was saying dementia.
I'm saying dimension.
Yeah, I like what Eldar said, which is mystery.
Yeah.
Because mystery involves, like, order beyond just, like, one stage.
So,
and
would you go further and say, therefore, every dialogue has a mystery, which you then have to link together with the other ones in order to climb through them, with them?
Yeah.
Ah.
And I'm thinking,
maybe he's not so interested in answers as he is in producing minds that hold questions and can pursue it through a series of dialogue.
Yeah.
In that sense, maybe it's like a compulsive exercise of gymnastics or like a free exercise where you go to these different dialogues to complete your vision of and your mystery and your puzzle.
Mm.
Like the logos of dreams.
Mm.
And he's like,
okay, well, let's have now enough time to go back with Jeff's dream.
I was gonna offer that it may be like in the Parmenides where you return to the beginning and see what the consequences are if you hold this hypothesis. So he may be exploring...
This hypothesis you mean we're raising?
No, that each of the dialogues is exploring an idea. But in that in that dialogue, it leads you to return to it in a way of what he hasn't explored in greater depth.
Sure.
So,
sure.
Like the second he doesn't...
Or you could take Aldar's view and say maybe you could take the Parmenides and locate all the other dialogues within them.
Yeah, I've had that view.
Yeah,
as well as Eldar.
They say let's go back to the beginning. He says, maybe us go back, please go back to the beginning.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I pray
for them, sure.
Sorry
good.
To do this last
good.
Minute. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. happy to offer my place for a chat on Saturday morning. Is that
Good.
But I'm going to have to ask everybody to leave by 12:30.
That's fair.
I have an appointment.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
Thanks, Steve.
Okay. Unless you want to kick around something else.
Have we finished with the latches? Have we finished with the latches?
I don't know. Have you?
No.
No, no. You have to say something.
Well, I was trying to figure out how it fits, as you always say, how it fits the beginning.
I have a question regarding what Barbara brought up when we started.
I would always think it's important to blame it on Barbara.
Yes. Regarding all men seek the good.
No.
Even though that's, I understand what you mean when you say it's not true, or as long as it's in the outside world and people are going to, I don't know, chasing money or whatever. But my question is, isn't that because their intention is actually on some level
good
and they want to seek the self, but they just don't know that that's their intention.
Well,
is that fair?
See, I think it's very rare for people to have an interest in the self.
Do you mean it's rare for them to be aware that that's what they're interested in?
Both.
Okay.
If you try something, print your card out. I'll help you know yourself. Pass it around.
But that's bad marketing.
What would you suggest instead?
Well, help you get rich. and then sneak
okay,
in.
Look, like this. There's no doubt about that statement. What people really desire when they seek for anything is that what they seek they want to call good. They only seek and are into actions for whatever it is if they think what they're doing is good. Right? Agree?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you believe it? Then no one ever sees something that is bad knowing it's bad.
Right.
They are all mistaken at those moments because they think the bad for them will bring them some benefit. Therefore, they're going to pursue the bad because they think it's going to benefit them anyhow.
Right.
So, yes, you can say that. That's what people do.
So in this perspective, you could say that all men seek the good.
Yeah, on the level of motivation,
yeah.
On the level of motivation, it's simply said to be true. We could even put it better and say, what people really unknowingly desire for anything, they believe it's going to be good. Or gain some benefit. Yeah, that's people's motivation.
So they're really seeking the self, but
But
if you were to tell them that that's what they're seeking, then they'd be like, "What? I'm not doing that. That's useless."
Because we're talking about motivation, can you say that's what they really knowingly?
Well, no, definitely not knowingly. No. Not knowing.
Well, then they would be surprised to discover that, hey, what they're really seeking and whatever they're doing
is the self. Is the self.
You think they'll buy that?
No.
No.
That's why I said it's bad marketing. Yeah.
That's right. That's right. It's like... what other culture expresses that? Know thyself.
Tibetan Buddhism?
Which one?
Tibetan Buddhism.
Buddhism?
Tibetan Buddhism. In the very beginning of the Tibetan Book of the Dead, when they're like, shining, void, blissful, radiant, they say, knowing this is sufficient. And they give you orders like, know this.
In Tibetan yoga, they do have the idea of self.
Mm-hmm. And they direct you to know a certain
and
state.
And it plays a very significant role, apart from them.
We didn't have it.
All right. Okay. Tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay.
Somebody wants to show up about 10 minutes early. Help me get the place set up. That would be great. About 10 of 10.
If you would like to take the half and half.